you remember the GST rollout that happened on 1st of July 2017? If you look at the official GST Act, you would see that it is signed by an official named G. Narayan Raju, who was the secretary to the Government of India. Do you think that this entire decision on GST was taken by him alone? Obviously not. So there are a lot of people and a lot of processes involved in this entire process of decision making. So who decided to make the law? Who made the law and who ensured that the law is being followed and maintained everywhere? That is something which we are going to learn in this lesson. And in order to make this happen, in India there exists three important institutions: legislature, executive and judiciary. India being a democratic country, it is the people who rule the country. With a country with more than 133 crores of people living in India, it is very important that specific tasks are assigned to specific people, and that is why we have institutions. So we have the legislature with a task assigned to it to make laws. We have the executive to execute the laws made by the legislative, and we have the judiciary to ensure that these laws are being followed and being maintained in a peaceful manner. So let's get ahead and let's look at a few examples to understand legislature, executive and judiciary better. Let's talk about GST in more detail. In the year 2000, the then Prime Minister introduced the concept of GST, and thereafter a GST Council was set up. Now, even before we go ahead, let me tell you, GST is goods and services tax. The idea of having GST was to combine a large number of state and central taxes into a single tax to mitigate the ill effects of double taxation. Now, it was initially proposed that GST will be rolled out in April 2010, but due to several reasons that didn't happen. So finally, the bill was passed in Rajya Sabha on 3rd of August 2016. It was passed by Lok Sabha on 8th of August 2016. After getting consent from all the states, it was passed by the President of India in September 2016. So this is where the legislature plays a key role, where the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha and the President, all of them plays their part in passing the GST Act. Now after that comes the executive. So now the Gazette of India is informed. So Gazette of India is basically a public journal of the Government of India that prints all the official notices of the government. So after this, a senior official is given the task to draft and sign the official act, and that is where we see the signature of an official on the GST Act. So this is where the executive, that is the department which executes the decision, plays a role. In fact, the government tax department, which is also a part of the executive, ensures that this act which has been passed is now implemented and being followed by the citizens of the country. Now, after the GST is being rolled out or being implemented, what happens is a lot of citizens are not happy with it. A lot of them feels that there are flaws in GST. So where do they go? What do they do? So these people start filing cases in court. In fact, for example, a case was filed in the Delhi High Court against the compensation tax, which is a component in the GST. And the Delhi High Court gave its decision against the compensation tax. But when the same case was taken to the Supreme Court, the court gave its decision in favor of the compensation tax. And Supreme Court being the highest authority, the decision of the Supreme Court was final. So what do we notice in this entire process? So in order to pass that GST Act, it all started with the legislature, that is the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha and the President. Then it moved on to the executive, which included the PM, the ministers and the civil servants who actually do it. And then it goes on to the judiciary, who ensures that the citizens in the country are all happy with it. If they have any issue, they can come back to the judiciary. Let us now talk about another popular and controversial order of Government of India. In August 1990, Government of India issued an Office of Memorandum that stated 27% of the seats under civil services and posts under Government of India will be reserved for the socially and educationally backward classes. Earlier, reservation was limited only to SC and STs. So who made this big decision? So obviously there were a lot of big people and functionaries who were involved in this process of decision making. So let's see from where it all started. In 1979, Government of India appointed Mondal Commission. Mondal Commission was given a task to identify the socially and educationally backward classes and what can be done for their upliftment. In 1980, Mondal Commission gave their first report, and in that report, one of the recommendations was reservation. For a couple of years, this remained a topic of discussion in the parliament but was not implemented. Finally, in 1989, one of the political parties during the Lok Sabha elections mentioned it in their election manifesto that if they won the election, they would implement the Mondal Commission recommendations. And that year, that party won the election because maybe they got the confidence of the people and people voted for that party. Immediately after the elections, the bill got passed by both the houses of the parliament. The president also gave his official consent to pass the bill. And this is what the legislature does, right? In August 6th, 1990, the cabinet decided to implement the recommendations of the Mondal Commission. And finally, on August 7th, the prime minister gave a formal statement. And then was informed the Department of Personnel and Training and the senior officers there drafted and signed the order and sent it out. And this is what the executive does exactly. Not only this, but all the government departments in the country, whether it is the railways or the central banks or the state banks, all of them had to follow this reservation order. In fact, you must have seen that this reservation thing gets reflected in all these government job examination at center level as well as state levels, whether you talk about UPSC or SSC, all of these have these 27% reservation thing. Now, those who did not get the benefit of the reservation claimed that talent should be given more priority than reservation. Whereas those who got the benefit of the reservation said that their life were already full of challenges and they deserved to get the reservations. Now, as a result of all these conflicts, many cases were filed in the court. Supreme Court listened to both the parties and finally concluded that the decision of the Government of India was valid. However, looking at the controversy and the dissatisfaction among the citizens of the country, another memorandum was passed in 1993. And this memorandum very clearly stated that the well-to-do people from socially and educationally backward classes were not included to get the benefit of this order. So even looking at this example of the 1990 Office of Memorandum of the Government of India, we see that the decision basically was taken at the legislature, that is Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha and the president. Then it was executed by the executive, which included the ministers and the civil servants and finally the judiciary to settle down all the disputes. So keeping in mind all the examples that we discussed here, we have three institutions: legislature, the lawmaking body, which includes Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, and the president. We have executive, which executes the laws made by the legislature, and this includes the Council of Ministers along with the Prime Minister and the civil servants. And finally, the third one, that is judiciary, which settles down all kind of disputes between people and organizations, and this includes the courts at all levels: Supreme Court, High Court, and the district courts. I hope you found this lesson useful. So in the next video, that is part 2, we will talk about the legislature, that is the parliament. So see you all in the next lesson.